Hey, Bill Nye, the science guy here.
This is Salman Rushdie.
Hi, this is Julia Sweeney.
I'm Neil deGrasse Tyson.
This is Theo Wilson.
Hi, this is Dar Williams.
I'm Mr. Deity, and you're listening to the Humanist Hour. I command you to listen now, or I will smite you.
Yes, I am a sound scientist. Came to evaluate the evidence on a closed case, highly classified, confidential, in a race against the clock.
Hey, listeners, this is Jess, and you're listening to the Humanist Hour, the official podcast of the American Humanist Association. So, happy 2013. So, Todd and I were hoping to get this episode out in the last week of 2012, but, well, what can I say? My calendar stopped after December 21st, so I just assumed the world was going to end. No, kidding. But it didn't happen, so sorry that we're late. But so this is sort of a web special. It's an interview that Todd and I did with Cecil Bothwell a couple months ago. Cecil is a politician from Asheville, North Carolina, as well as a writer and a builder. And he's a great guy. He talks about his experience as a politician and an atheist. And he also does something that, in my opinion, is pretty cool toward the end of our interview. So enjoy this month's show. Enjoy our last show of 2012. And Todd and I look forward to giving you lots of great content in 2013. In the meantime, don't forget to visit thehumanisthour.org, where you can like us on Facebook, subscribe to our RSS feed, and learn about and listen to our previous episodes. So thank you one last time for supporting the Humanist Hour. Our numbers, our fans are growing, and that's very exciting. And enjoy Cecil Bothwell. This is Todd reporting from New York City via the telephone from a hotel room, which isn't actually his, by the way, and Cecil Bothwell over Skype.
Hi, Cecil. Welcome to the Humanist Hour. Thanks for joining us.
I'm pleased to be here.
You want to give a little quick rundown of your experience running for and holding office as an open humanist slash atheist?
I'll start with my story about how that came about. I have to say that although I've never really been a theist in any sense, my parents never made any much point of it. So I grew up in what I considered a post-theist household and world. I never made much of it, and I wasn't particularly out. I wasn't particularly closeted. It just, when you don't believe something, it seems a little strange to me, or it seemed a little strange to me to wear it on your sleeve. You know, I don't run around saying I don't believe in the flat earth or, you know, whatever. So it seemed of little consequence to me until I wrote a political biography of Billy Graham. And in the acknowledgments section in that book, I realized that people might think I was attacking Graham because of his religion or his beliefs. And in fact, what I was exposing was his political shenanigans. And so in the acknowledgments, I said, just for the record, I don't believe in supernatural beings of any stripe. And that was the only time I'd ever said anything publicly. Well, I did really well. I came in first out of 10 people in a primary for city council election. And some right-wingers here in Asheville got upset. They were afraid I'd actually win a seat. And so they ran two smear letters letting Asheville know that I was an atheist. And it probably had some effect on my election because I came in third. There were three seats open. I came in third in the general election after coming in first in the primary. So it probably had some effect. And then when I was going to be sworn in, another group tried to prevent my being sworn into office because the North Carolina Constitution still contains a clause that says you can't hold office if you deny the being of Almighty God.
Wow.
It's not enforceable. If it were ever taken to court, we actually hoped it would be. I mean, by that point, I was fired up, but nobody actually carried it through to a court challenge. It would have been thrown out at some level, maybe the U.S. Supreme Court, who knows.
From what I heard, the district attorney, it was brought to the DA, and DA wouldn't touch it because he knew it was a losing case from prior case law in other states nearby, like Herb Silverman's challenge in South Carolina.
Exactly. And they went to our city attorney, who said there's nothing there. They went to the attorney general of the state, and he said I don't know if he or his office said there's nothing there. But that did two things. One is it gave me a widespread notoriety for about 5 days. Rachel Maddow picked up on the story, and New York Times and LA Times. And at one point in the second week of December of 2009, when I Googled my name and atheist, I came up with upward of 200,000 hits on Google in 8 languages.
Wow.
So it, and the other thing it did was it made me super aware of how touchy the subject was and how imperative it was for us to be out. So it changed my mind completely about, you know, about not saying who I was and what I was up to. It's had a really interesting effect on city council since I've been on the council. During that same election, as it turned out, another person was elected, a fellow who is probably atheist, but will say nothing about it. He takes no position publicly. And then a Jewish woman who's an attorney was elected. Now, about seven years ago, thanks to things like the Freedom from Religion Foundation, it used to be that the city council members each said an invocation at the beginning. No, excuse me. They had a minister come to an invocation at every council meeting. And the city attorney had told them this isn't going to float. There are cases around the country. So they switched to where each council member in turn did an invocation. Well, at my election, the whole tone, the whole tenor of the invocations shifted. I do secular messages, quoting whoever is on the top of my mind at the time. The Jewish woman writes poetry and all kinds of, again, very secular messages. The other fellow refuses to do invocations. And so there's a couple of Christian invocations that can't come around. But I just sit up during the prayers and look around, and it's like the audience has been given permission to sit up and look around. And 10 to 15% at every meeting don't bow their heads, don't pretend to pray. It's just the tone has shifted. And I think that's been a real positive thing. You know, we've sort of allowed secularism to emerge in our council chambers.
I've always found that to be an interesting phenomenon, because I do the same thing in any other event where there's praying at a big public event. I'll look around too, because it's a great way to see who else the non-believers are. And oftentimes you'll meet eyes and just kind of nod and smile subtly, like, hey, I know what you're thinking. And I've noticed a distinctive pattern that it tends to be the younger people too, most often. There's people across all spectrums, but particularly in the students, there seems to be a lot more students looking around and not bowing their heads. It's kind of a cool phenomenon. But we're saying this on the air, so we've got to be careful, because we're outing our secret to the other side. They'll figure out who we are. All they have to do is look up during the prayer too.
But they won't.
But they won't. They're afraid they might burst into flames. So,
right. And a lot of people are checking messages on their iPhones and texting and doing whatever they do. But you know, they've been excused from pretending, which is a lot of pretense around prayer in public places. I also, whenever I say the pledge, we have to say the Pledge of Allegiance. You know, that's like, it's sort of almost mandated that we do that at the beginning of each meeting. I say one nation under law.
Ooh.
Because it is one nation under law. And I found that it's easier to stick a word in than to try to just say one nation, beat,
right,
indivisible. There are reasons to not even say the pledge, but that's a battle I don't really need to take on.
Has anyone noticed that you substitute under law?
Nobody's noticed, because they're all saying God.
Right.
So the next adventure for me was, we currently have a congressman, a blue dog, who's literally in bed with the C Street crowd, the family in Washington. He lives at the C Street house when he's in Washington, makes a great commotion about his religiosity. His name is Heath Shuler. And I was discontent with him on many, many fronts. And finally, in February of 2011, He voted for the Stupak Amendment, which would have redefined rape under federal law as only forcible rape. And that was the last straw for me. And I said, someone has got to primary this guy. So I jumped into the Democratic primary. And so I ran in this congressional district. In the middle of the run, I was working on it for a year. In the middle of the run, they redistricted here to make this district even more conservative and Republican than it had been. And yet, in January of this year, our polling indicated that I had a really good chance of beating Heath Shuler, an incumbent congressman, in the primary. He announced he was dropping out, so he's retiring after this cycle. His chief of staff jumped into the race, got a ton of funding. But the thing that helped, and I lost, I ended up losing the primary in May. However, there's a couple of lessons around the question of atheism, secularism. One is, it was never brought up in public arenas except by one of my opponents. A second opponent jumped in then too. The population, the people did not ask me about it. At two house parties, two of my supporters on separate occasions asked me what I was going to do to confront the issue. And I said, well, unless somebody brings it up, that's not an issue to me. And I said, if I'm asked, I will say, I'm not running to be your minister. I'm running for Congress. And that that separation is urgently important for churches as well as for secular people, because it protects churches from interference from the government, et cetera, you know. However, now, okay, I didn't make an issue, and no one in my presence made it an issue except the one opponent who a couple of times called me out as an atheist. But the churches around here, we had an amendment one, they called it, on our primary ballot to flat out ban same-sex relationships, recognition of same-sex relationships, government. Like Asheville provides benefits to same-sex partners, to our employees. Apparently, if that's challenged in court, that may go down now. And the whole thing was to be afraid, very, very afraid of gay marriage. And apparently, we heard, but I don't have any recordings, that evangelical ministers were preaching in favor of Amendment 1 and telling their people to vote against that atheist Cecil Bothwell. So it was a piece of my loss in the primary. I won in my county. I won in two other counties out of the 11 counties in the district. So even there, it didn't, you know, I managed to pull it off in some of the counties. But we have another blue dog, a Democrat who's been nominated, who is cozied up to the C Street crowd already. And so we're going to have another strong theist, either he or his Tea Party opponent, who the Republican may win. So that's my more or less short version of my political history.
See, so both you and Todd are from North Carolina, and I just assume it's down south. It's more conservative and probably more religious. Is that actually the case? What are the demographics like for your constituents?
In my city, Asheville, it's a very progressive city. I sometimes call it the diamond on the buckle of the Bible Belt.
I like that.
We have a diverse city. We have, in fact, right now, after there's been a subsequent election, we elect half of our council every 4 years. So I was elected in 2009. We've had another election. There are now three Unitarian Universalists on council, one non-religious person, a secular Jew, and two Christians. So we're hardly, a theocratic headquarters in Asheville.
Right.
Buncombe County is liberal for the South, but outside of city limits, it's more conservative. The 11th District, which is huge. It's as big as Massachusetts because the mountains are thinly populated. So geographically, we spread over 11 counties, is quite conservative. And religion is a big deal for elected officials, especially. And so I'd say that what you think about when you think of the Deep South is probably quite true of the mountains of North Carolina.
Okay. And are you ever able to overlap on things that aren't directly tied to religion, but just other things that we believe in socially?
Well, the evidence is not good. Yeah. Buncombe County went for Obama in 2008. None of the other counties did. If that's some measure of liberal social views.
Sure.
There's considerable racism expressed and around Obama, even. You hear it out in the counties. The Amendment 1 was defeated in Buncombe County, and it was defeated in the Research Triangle area, Durham, Chapel Hill, the liberal bastions in the state, but the amendment was overwhelmingly approved by the counties out here. So gay rights are not much appreciated. On the other hand, there's a libertarian streak that has some of those interesting liberal issues. You know, this is where white lightning was brewed in large quantities, and there's a mountain ethic of not liking government interference on a personal level, on personal choices. Right. There's a lot of support for legalization of marijuana, for instance. There are a lot of retired hippies who went off the grid and live out in these mountains, and they tend to be socially liberal. Right. So there are, it's not solidly one way or the other, but I would say it's still majority pretty conservative, old-fashioned Democrat or Republican, you know, sort of Strom Thurmond Democrats who became Republicans.
It's interesting because the map that came out after Amendment 1, I saw one going around on Facebook, which was by county who voted to eliminate any chances of kind of marriage equality or civil union equality for that matter. And, you know, who was opposed and who was against. And all the counties that were in favor of equality were homes to the major universities in the state.
Right.
Something like 10 counties. And it was, no, well, here's UNC, here's NC State, here's UNC Charlotte, here's UNC Wilmington. It was just very interesting to see that. And is it because those counties are younger, or is it because they're better educated? It's hard to say, but it was definitely not a coincidence. It was correlation there.
We have UNC Asheville here and Warren Wilson College, both of which I'm sure contributed to the results. And I think both the young and the better educated. In fact, I just noticed in the news this morning as we're speaking, I don't know when this is broadcast or podcast, but that Focus on Family is toning down its anti-gay message.
Really?
Yeah. They're saying it's not, there's some kind of, they're toning it down that it's not a major sin or something to that effect.
Interesting.
It's no longer a mortal sin. They will no longer be tortured forever in hell. They'll be treated kindly in hell.
Right. Or the wait tables.
So, Cecil, what does your future in politics in North Carolina look like now?
Well, I think unless something huge changes, I'm going to run for re-election to city council. I feel like I've been a pretty effective voice on some issues that matter. For instance, we did get the domestic partner benefits passed. We are reducing our carbon footprint by 4% per year. We're definitely moving the city in good directions during a real difficult economic time, as many municipalities are facing that right now. But I haven't thought beyond the next city council election. It's interesting that despite the trashing of me by those who don't like me being non-theist or atheist or whatever they want to call me, tomorrow, the weekly newspaper will be out that does their annual best of, you know, you can vote on the restaurants and the, you know, all that, which is basically an advertising ploy. They like to be able to tell a restaurant, hey, you're our reader's favorite, so why don't you advertise with us? Sure. But they also include other categories just for the heck of it. And tomorrow I've been told I'll be, for the third year in a row, the most popular elected official in Asheville.
Hey now, that's cool. Congratulations.
Wow.
Yeah. So I think that bodes well. I mean, I don't set huge store by the prize because I used to be on that paper staff and I know that the numbers of voters are not all that high. That's a secret. Okay.
We'll edit that part right out, Cecil. We'll cut it.
It bodes well for reelection. I was going to say, as far as potential for running for Congress again, of course, my supporters are interested in me. Many of them are interested in me trying again. There's a reality level, though, that has nothing much to do with my non-religion, but more with my effectiveness. The truth is, today's my 62nd birthday, and the next congressional election, I'll be 64. At that age, to get in there and stay in long enough to get the kind of longevity, the seniority that makes you an effective congressman, I'm probably getting to the far end of the age limit. I mean, I know some people stay in there till they're 90, but whereas here in the city, I'm in a much smaller pond. I'm one of seven council members. I'm having more effect now than I did in my first couple of years because I've learned the ropes. And so I may feel better just sticking with the city council. Because I feel like I'm accomplishing something.
Sure. I'm certainly a firm believer in the potential of local politics. That's for sure.
And there are so many issues that could be handled better locally. For instance, local food, that's a movement across the country. And we've got a strong local food movement here in Asheville. And we're abetting that by setting up a food policy council for the city. We're working on using vacant land for community gardens. We've set up a lot more farmers. We permitted a lot more farmers markets around the city. We're working on farmers markets, particularly in low wealth areas where they have less access to fresh foods. So that's an important piece. Another one, we've been elected Beer City USA by the beer magazines or whatever for a few years running. And apparently it's in large part due to our water. The brewers tell me that the water is really good. And so New Belgium from out in Fort Collins, Colorado is building their eastern plant here. And they're part of an operation in Fort Collins called Fort Zed. That's a zero energy district. That's they're trying to achieve net zero. That is that local businesses and residences are going to be trying to generate as much power as they use. Wow. By using their investment in solar and wind and by dropping their use. And I've started a movement here toward an Asheville metro area zero energy district, and New Belgium's involved with it. The Research Triangle Regional Partnership is wanting to help us out. I've been out to Fort Collins to visit their projects there. And so I think we're going to expand from the River Arts District, a net zero district. And of course, that's an impossibly high goal under current technology. But still, reducing energy use is good economically for those of us who subscribe to human-caused climate change. It's an essential. But even on the economic level, businesses are finding out that they can save substantial money. So I'm excited to be part of that project. And the truth is that my presence as an elected non-theist official carries through, not just in the prayers in council meeting, but when we've got a loony who comes and speaks in public comment almost every week, who calls me out as an atheist once in a while. People seeing me behaving like another normal council member weighing the issues, casting my votes based on what the people have given as feedback and on what seems to be best for the community, I hope is helping to normalize humanism.
Of course, if you ran a national office in one, you might be able to have this a similar benefit on the cap on the hill.
That's true. That is true. And I'm still weighing that. You know, that's 2 years, well, year and a half before I have to really think hard on that. For a year, the money raising is we spent close to $100,000, and it's amazing how you cut right through it.
Oh, I believe it.
Back when you got initially elected and there was the hubbub about you being elected as an atheist and the violation of the North Carolina Constitution, is it true that one of the lead voices, if not the lead voice against you, trying to get you tossed from office was like a former head of the NAACP?
Yes, we have an odd character here in Asheville who was head of the local or the Western North Carolina NAACP. He left under some kind of difficult circumstances. It was never a public, there was a problem. I don't know what the problem was. And he immediately joined the Sons of the Confederacy. And he, for years, although less so now, he's getting on in years, he would parade around town in a Confederate uniform carrying the stars and bars, and he'd stand on bridges over the interstate holding the Confederate flag. And he insisted that slavery was a benign partnership between slaves and masters. And he formed a nonprofit which shared an address in Georgia with a group that printed really hateful racist propaganda. I don't know what their relationship was, but they had the same address. And so he was the fellow.
Is this a black guy?
Yes. Yes. But he's the one who actually carried the water for
self-loathing much.
Yeah, that's what it really feels like.
It's funny.
He and I were both interviewed on one of the national radio programs during that period. And he told the host there that it was because his father was a Baptist minister that he felt that he had to do it to defend the state and the city against my atheism.
I was going to say, it's funny that you hear about the some people who are really homophobic. It's potentially because they have this self-hatred directed, you know, because they are gay and they feel so guilty about it, but you can't really apply that logic to this case.
You'd think an African American in the Deep South would be one of the first people to stand up and say we shouldn't ban anyone from holding public office. But, you know, it sounds like this dude has some other issues.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, it's just like, just because you're a member of a certain type of discrimination doesn't mean you can't discriminate on other grounds. But the thing is, he seems to be partnering with this organization who is participating and discriminating against him for his race. Like, it doesn't make any sense. I don't understand.
Right. Yeah. They, by all appearances, are a white supremacist organization. So that was very, very odd.
It's strange how we let certain things divide us, and we ended up getting divided and conquered at points on issues like this, where people are one minority group is persuaded to discriminate against another minority group. And I hope to see in the future more of all of minority groups standing together with majority groups against discrimination and stop letting, you know, these small differences divide us. It's amazing how little empathy some people can have. You know, they can look at the fact that themselves or their ancestors or their close friends have been directly discriminated against and then turn around and do the same thing to someone else without even blinking or realizing the horrid irony.
Right. And I feel like humanism provides the perfect umbrella for that, for what you're saying needs to happen, Todd.
Yes.
Yeah.
And P.Z. Myers has been speaking out about that lately. I was lucky enough to share the stage with him at the Atheist Alliance of America over Labor Day. And then again at the Florida Humanist, the Humanists of Florida conference in Lakeland a couple of weeks ago. And he's urging that we broaden, that we make it clear, as the American Humanist Association has, that that we include a lot of people, and that, that and that there can be separate groups within, like LGBT group or a racial justice group or a Latino justice group or a feminist group, but that we should all be constantly trying to be inclusive.
Absolutely. So Cecil, for our listeners who are out there who are maybe contemplating or curious about how to get started in their local politics, I know that the Reason Rally and at all the sort of the conferences that I've been going to lately, the message that I hear is get involved in your politics, get involved in your politics, run for office. And it's geared towards students, it's geared towards young adults. And what advice do you have for them?
The things that have stood me in good stead, especially at this local level, are, first of all, I became an internet activist quite early. I was publishing a weekly newsletter back in, email newsletter in 1995, and continued to gain subscribers. I had a syndicated radio show at the time, just a radio commentary and a print commentary, and I began to collect names and, you know, email addresses, so that today my email list is about 18,000 people, and much of it clustered within my county, and like 12,000 are in my county, and the other 6,000 are elsewhere, and mostly in North Carolina, but then across the country. Having that kind of, you know, the internet gives us access to people in a way that it was hard to afford in a past era. And I've got to say that if you're non-theist, that the atheist community is very supportive. I got donations from all across the country. I got press coverage for my congressional run, and I got donations nationwide. In fact, internationally, from Americans who were teaching in Japan or in Canada, or all, who wanted to support an atheist candidate. So there are resources there. So I would say cultivate your contacts. Don't ever give away or sell your email list, because you get a reputation. I mean, it's better if you protect it. You can use it for good causes, but make sure you don't ever let it become a spam, you know, tool. So organize, be active, be visible in your community in any way that suits you. I was a slam poet in the early 90s, did poetry slams, and did pretty well, won the Southeast and went to the Nationals and all that stuff. And I got a reputation for being, I guess, a little bit cool among a certain segment. I've been active in environmental causes right along. Then I had the platform of being an editor and a reporter for a while. And again, I think that gave me visibility in the community. So all those pieces added up when I decided, after I left the newspaper, when I decided to jump in. But showing up, you know, Alan's adage was showing up's 90% or 95 or 99%. You hear it quoted different ways, of success. But being a participant in the community is really, really important. So, and it could be volunteering to be on a city board or a commission. It could be volunteering with a community group that cleans up parks, or faith communities also. I mean, that may sound strange for humanists, but we have an out atheist minister in our UU church here. So there's a lot of social progressives connected to Unitarian Universalism. So all of those pieces, I'd say, are what, and don't be afraid to ask for money. It's really tough, but until we find a way to change that in our political system, it takes money even at the local level. My first run, I spent about $28,000 for city council run. Advertising costs money, or yard signs cost money, and you have to believe enough in yourself that you're willing to go to your friends and then a expanding circle and say, will you kick in something?
How do you see things being different for humanist candidates 10 years from now than they are today, if at all?
I think that the news from the Secular Student Alliance is remarkable. The number of new chapters at colleges across the country, the number of new high school chapters, the fact that more and more young people are identifying as non-religious means that it's becoming less and less of an issue. In fact, this year, I guess we heard a poll, was it a Gallup poll maybe, that said that over 50% of Americans would vote for an atheist for president who was otherwise qualified.
Yep.
So I think it's definitely going to roll. I think that Sean Faircloth's goal of having 20 out Congress people by 2020 is certainly doable. They're probably already there.
they're not out. Exactly.
Right.
This goes back like 4 or 5 years. Back like 4 or 5 years, but our contacts and people who know a lot of people in DC found, I think it was 27 people, members of Congress, willing to admit they were non-theists, but only willing to admit it behind closed doors.
Right.
Just like absolutely no way that they would want to do it. And only one of them, Pete Stark, of that group of about 27, was willing to come out publicly and say, yes, I'm a non-theist. So you know, hopefully as times change and we come out more and it becomes less of an oddity and less stigmatized, hopefully more and more people in Congress will be willing to be more open about their beliefs.
Certainly so. I think that's changing quite rapidly. Seeing the numbers, Hemant Mehta did a presentation, I guess, in both Denver and in Lakeland lately, about the changing demographics and how the millennial generation is vastly less religious than two generations back. And that has to have an effect. Fewer and fewer people demand a religious test for office, even though every presidential candidate and president ends every speech with God bless America. It's sort of just a routine saying. I don't think a lot of people necessarily subscribe to it. I read something really funny last night that's sort of germane to this conversation. There's a book out about a year or so called Packing for Mars. It's about our space effort and where NASA's headed with all of the programs coming on all the way from Gemini or the Mercury program up to the prospective Mars mission in the 2030s. Well, on Skylab and on the space station, Muslims were really concerned about having to kneel down and pray to Mecca 5 times a day because they circle the earth every 90 minutes. And so you'd be praying.
That's great.
You'd be praying 5 times every 90 minutes. So whoever makes the rules for Islam agreed that, I guess it must be whatever countries were contributing astronauts or cosmonauts or whoever they were, that they only had to do it 5 times within a 24-hour cycle. And since they couldn't possibly bow toward Mecca, because by the time if they bowed toward Mecca, by the time they prayed, their butt would be facing Mecca. They just have to generally aim their heads toward the earth. And it shows how completely arbitrary those kind of religious rules are. It makes them seem so silly. Oh, and you can't actually kneel because
of Islamics.
Right. So they have to just make they have to bend their heads toward their knees. Generally face the earth.
Generally. That's great.
Those kind of examples in everyday life illustrate more and more how empty those religious concepts are.
Yeah.
Speaking of Islamic butts reminds me of something else I saw today. A friend, this is a big segue, but hey, it's not every day you talk about Muslim butts. So I get an email from a buddy of mine this morning with a Islam Q&A website, which someone really asked this question, and this looks like it's a legitimate site. Are we alone when in the bathroom? Can there be jinn with us? If so, what steps do we need to take to protect our modesty? And it goes on to say, praise be to Allah, it is known that jinn like going to uncleanly places. And so fortunately, there are prayers that can be said to Allah to create, and I'm not kidding here, to create an invisible shield or veil that covers up the modesty that goes beyond just the door, but actually can lock out the jinn from harming you and doing evil to you while you're defecating.
Wow.
While you're on websites, there's another, I think, apt segue. Mitt Romney was here in Asheville this last week, and he made the obligatory visit to Billy Graham. And Billy Graham, who's no longer preaching, is no longer keeping his politics in the closet. And he announced that he was a full supporter, and he would do everything he could to get Romney elected. So that was in the news. Well, as of 2 days ago, the Billy Graham Evangelistic Association website said that Mormonism was a cult, and that it disappeared yesterday.
Interesting.
Somebody got a screenshot.
Well, ever since I heard that, Cecil, you won a poetry slam, I forget how wide the range, how far you said you got, but I believe you said it was something like Southeast.
Yeah, I think it was 7 Southeast states.
That's pretty cool. Now I would love to hear something. Not to put you on the spot. You can say no.
Yeah, I could. Let me think which one I want to pull out.
And
so Todd pulled this on me in Asheville, I believe, didn't you?
And I did. And he's really, and he's really good, by the way.
I believe it. I totally believe it. As soon as he said it, I was like, I can totally see that. Now, a poetry slam means you're going head to head against someone, right?
Yeah, that you have poetry slams as they were organized. I suppose they still may be. I don't know. Poems had to be no longer than 3 minutes. And you were scored by people in the audience, like the Olympics, who had cards they could hold up with
cards. That's great. So Cecil, you'll go first, and Todd, you'll go second, and I'll score you both.
Okay. Well, how about I not go, but I can give Cecil a beat. I can go.
Cecil, that's totally up to you if you want to use that or not.
I don't think this one, I don't need a beat track for.
Not this one. Thanks though, Todd.
Yeah. Okay. I wrote this poem during the winter of Sarajevo's uproar in the early 90s. That's when I was slamming poetry. And this is one that stuck with me over that time. It's called Little Whittled Wooden Women. I am enamored of wood, and when left alone, am prone to whittle little wooden women. When my best friend saw the first of these, a hiker with a knapsack, she said, "Hey, you've got a knack, sap." I told her it's a snap that I can see the figures in the grain and carve to set them free. A tree remembers. That old trunk holds memories of lives long past, like childhood photographs. It is clear tonight. A chill wind rattles bare branches as I toss another stick of furniture in the fire and read Frost, doing neither lightly. Respecter of wood and limb and figure and craft, I would not feed my stove this chair unless weathered and weakened beyond repair. Fire and ice, posit the poet, stand opposed, potential conclusions to our little adventure. But reading Robert by my flaring chair, my mind is drawn to Sarajevo, searching for the figures there. This post-Cold War winter has proved post-neither in Sarajevo. Ice has demanded fire, and every tree in the city has been cut and burned. Ice has demanded fire, and the furniture in the homes has been given to the blaze. Ice has demanded fire, and the books on the shelves have been handed into the flames. And one must suppose the little whittled wooden women as well. What surreal triage that calls to mind. Hey, honey, what do we cook on tonight, your piano or my guitar? Value versus portability, no small issue in time of war. And if we choose to warm the baby's food on Noah Webster's fire, do we start with A or Z or foreign words and phrases? When a city burns its trees, it gives up shade and beauty and the juicy fruit of summers yet to come. And with the furniture, utility and comforter given to the flames, and then the books and the hard-won hope of history is handed into the blaze. And one wonders what with the little wooden women, memory perhaps, of a time when there was time to search for figures in the grain. I set poetry aside, pick up knife and chunk of cherry. There's a little wooden woman there who needs to be set free, to live a while on my shelf, to lend her warm peace to this room, waiting, waiting, always waiting for the day when ice cries out for fire and memory is a luxury we can no longer afford.
Wow. I'm holding up a 10. You can't see it, Cecil.
Thank you.
Bravo.
Yeah, that was amazing. That was all from memory,
Bravo.
Too?
Bravo.
Yeah, yeah.
Wow.
I can attest that he can do that on the spot with no notes in front of him.
I certainly believe it.
Well, I've got about 3 or 4 others that I actually, that are still that committed to memory.
That's awesome. Is there anything, Cecil, that we haven't talked about yet that you would like to talk about?
Only this, that I was sort of brought into the humanist atheist movement by accident. You know, I was dragged in by my political opponents. And I understand now how important it is for us to be out, how important it is for us to share our stories, to share them with our dear ones, to share them in public. We are in danger of losing a lot of the separation of church and state in this country, because even though religion is shrinking, it's quite powerful. The mega churches control a lot of money, and there's a lot of suasion in Congress. And I really hope others will be emboldened to step up, to step out, and make this the kind of world, a really humanist world, where we care for each other, where we live the golden rule, where we make interpersonal ethics really important, not what you believe, but who you are, not what your gender is, not what your gender orientation is, not what, you know, not what your color is. We're all in this together.
I'm in. I like it.
Well said, sir.
Yeah, thank you.
Cecil, thanks so much for being on the show.
Thanks for having me on here.
That was Cecil Bothwell, politician, writer, and builder from Asheville, North Carolina, and Southern, Southeastern region poetry slam champion. I think he should probably add that. Someone get to his wiki quick and add that, all right? You can learn more about Cecil from his website, bothwell2012.com, or his blog, which is Bothwell's blog, bothwellsblog.wordpress.com. So definitely check him out, support him. He's a great guy, and we'll see you soon. Thanks for listening to The Humanist Hour. I'm Jess Constantine.